Thank you. name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Name of the Lord, and of the
Lord. And also of you.
My brothers and sisters, this morning we gather to celebrate sacrament. That is a special moment, especially God's presence in the life of a married couple. We understand that the marriage is just not as simple as God's life. But one in which we invoke the presence of God, not only his presence today, but each day in the lives of his son. For it is only with the presence of God and his grace and mercy that this union will prosper and fruit. And then enjoy the happiness. As we begin to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us first be aware of God's presence among us. And let us seek his mercy and forgiveness for our daily sins.
Oh,
Let us pray. Father, you have made the marriage, the bond of marriage, a holy mystery, a symbol of Christ's love for his church. Hear our prayers today for time and body. With faith in you and in each other, they pledge their love today. May their lives always bear witness to the reality of that love. We ask you this through Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. gave himself for us. Defer to one another out of reverence to Christ. Wives should be submissive to their husbands, as if to the Lord, because the husband is the head of his wife, just as Christ is the head of his body, the church, as well as the Savior. As the church submits to Christ, so wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church. He gave himself up for her to make her holy, purifying her in the bath of water by the power of the word, to present to himself a glorious church, holy and immaculate, without stain or wrinkle or anything of that sort. Husbands should love their wives as they do their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. Observe that no one ever hates his own flesh. No, he nourishes it, takes care of it as Christ cares for the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall be made into one. This is a great foreshadowing. I mean that it refers to Christ and the church. In any case, each one should love his wife as he loves himself. The wife, for her part, showing her respect for her husband. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I was going to say, they could have chosen in that second reading about wives and husbands,
there was a short form which wasn't as explicit about submission. Most people take that right. But they just climbed right in there and took a long reading. Because it caused a lot of tension among families and the beauty is they chose the readings, I think the theme that emerged for me most clearly is the one in unity. If you notice through the readings, that theme, the two shall be one, we shall be brought together in the Lord. In some ways, we're witnessing the birth of the family. There's a one of the questions in the PLI. We go over it, always talks about this new family. And so we don't attend a marriage that simply leaves it with two people who happen to live together in the license, but rather the birth of a new family. And it calls for unity. And we hear about unity in the readings, we see unity, it's called unity. So the mother is lighting a candle, and after they're married, they blow up and separate candles, and they're getting united in Christ. So a lot of symbolism about unity, and it's easy to talk about, but it's very difficult to sustain. Unity is not established today, it's begun today. Or actually, it's blessed in the sacramental cord. It's begun before, during the courtship. And in those days when they said, I want to spend my life with you. But it's a process which has to continue. And it's a very difficult one, you know, especially in our society today. Unity is more spoken about than women. And we see along the way so many hopes and dreams that are broken and dashed. And some of the best intentions somehow crushed in the process of life. And so today we pray for unity, but in the Catholic understanding, it's not that unity is simply a community. In Judaism, certainly, we see already the delight of the scriptures in married life. But one of the great gifts God has given to humanity is the human gift of love as expressed in man and woman. But in the Christian understanding, it's deeper. It's a union which finds its very roots in faith in Christ Jesus. Somehow it's no longer two people involved in marriage, but three people. God himself. And I believe any union is to be sustained. Any deep unity, it has to be the love of the man and woman rooted in God. There are too many powers in society which tend to suffer. They will tell you, you must seek your fulfillment, you must seek yours. And if that means you toss the other overboard, that's okay. Others will tell you, your career is more important. Or you're changing, so leave the other one behind. And that's not the Christian understanding. The Christian understanding is this is a union until death of the other. It is something holy, not something simply a licensed sinner. I don't know how a couple could make it to that without a deep, common faith in Christ and the Lord, and without living that life in a daily way. Prayer and involvement in the church and in ministry to your brothers and sisters. How do you do that? In the first reading, I think we got a message on what unity means. A man and woman on their wedding night get out of bed and they kneel together on the floor.
And united in prayer.
Many times in your life, daily in your life, there will be times to thank God. Most of the time to petition for His grace and mercy. At times to beg for His strength and favor. At times to rejoice and time to grieve and cry to God. Can't imagine a marriage today without God being the center. Ensuring stability in good times and bad. Being the rock and the fortress upon which that bond is built. Anything else washes away under the stress of story and grief. Only rooted in Christ Jesus and in God. In our second reading, we're told by the great apostle Paul that if you want to be one, you can't lord it over each other. But it's true about the husband's head of the family. He's really the servant of his wife. And the one who must bring God fully into the family. And he will not demand submission. He will not lord it over. But in some ways, he will reflect the love of God in the very moment. And in the same way, that desire to love and to serve belongs to both parties of the marriage. She will love her husband as the church loves Christ. And he will love the wife as Christ loves the church. It's never the love of authority or control, but one of reverence and respect. Paul concludes that reading by saying that to sum it all up, to sum it all up, it's love and reverence for each other. Never control, not manipulation, but rather love and service and reverence. And then once again in our gospel, we hear the two become one. And I think everything has, one of the things we learn, and you have learned, engaged in color, that love is not a feeling so much as a decision. Love, less feeling than a decision. Today I will love, whether I feel like loving or not. I make decisions. In our society, we tend to like the feeling of love. Everybody wants to have that feeling. But it's much tougher to do the daily work, sometimes it is work, of being faithful and doing the loving thing in this relationship. Even at great personal sacrifice, even if we're dying to one's desires, so as to serve the Father. And I think the same way, if I were to pick out a single word, again, which seems to signify the thing in this way, the word is unity. And to make decisions every day of your lives together, to make decisions to underscore those things which will increase your unity in Christ. And I think you make choices of this job. Is this going to enable us to be together? Making this choice of the way I behave, will this bring unity? Making these choices, will that strengthen our unity? And then, of course, they say, talk through. Talk and talk and talk and talk. Just not get rid of the coaching. Always talk, communicate. Share what's happening. And again, as you share your deepest dreams and even your darkest emotions, you will find your love, which will grow over the years. In the time of 20 years, you'll look better than she does to you. And in 20 years, you'll have cancer over you. Because you will have understood dwelling love in your spirits and in your hearts and in your lives. I'd like to conclude, as I do, every wedding event with a story. And it's a story of my grandparents. I have a bunch of stories about them. But my favorite one, which many of you have heard before, so you know this for a moment. I'm trying to think, it was about, I think it was 25 years, something like that. My sister Rita got married. It was a pretty big wedding for 500 people. And my grandfather was beginning to get, well, he wasn't beginning, he had arrived before. We couldn't remember much. But he was still at the wedding. So, of course, I have been privileged to help celebrate that liturgy. But it was in the collar. So he came up to me. He came up and he said, "Father, will you do me a favor?" Oh, I said, "Sure, Grandpa, what was wrong?" But he really, I don't think he remembered that it was his grandson. As good looking as I might be, and somehow I stepped his way. So at any rate, "Father, will you do me a favor?" I said, "Sure." So he called me over and said, "Will you introduce me to that woman over there with the hook in her breast?" Dear Lord, he's 83 years old, he's trying to figure something out, and there's the priest to help him. Poor things are in slow. Well, as I looked down the line, the woman he was pointing to was my grandmother. Over there, 62 years. See, she's got me. Never been the word. But out of 400 people in that room, it was still the deepest love, the love of this world. That's the deepest kind of love. And it goes where the mind goes, the memory goes, the hair goes, all those things go. But the love's so deep, that it's much bigger and broader and deeper than the limitations of the human spirit. I wish you that kind of love. That will only come out of a love built, I believe, upon your faith in Christ Jesus, and upon a life aimed at unity and work at unity every day. May God really give you love. Really, our relationship grows and grows each day. May you gracefully, that is full of grace, grow old together. May you know the joys of family life. And may one day you enter into the full glory of heaven together. May God bless you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now this lovely couple depicted a rather beautiful instruction on the sacrament of matrimony. So I'm just going to ask them if they will come over here while I share that instruction with them. And the rest of you can remain seated. My dear friends in Christ, as you know, you are about to enter into a union most sacred and most serious, a union which was established by God Himself. By it, He gave a man to share the greatest work of creation, the work of the continuation of the human race. And in this way, He sanctified human love and enabled man and woman to help each other live as children of God by sharing the common life under His fatherly care. Because God Himself is His author, marriage is of its very nature only an institution required of those who enter into it a complete and unreserved gift of sight. describe his own life for the church. That is to the people of God, whom he conducted redeemed by his own life. And so he gave the Christians a new vision of what Mary might want to be. A life of self-sacrifice and love by his own. It is for this reason that his apostle, St. Paul, clearly sees that marriages were now at all times to be considered a great mystery, intimately bound up with the supernatural union of Christ and the Church, which union is also to be attacked. This union then is most serious because it will bind you together for life in a relationship so close and so intimate that it will profoundly influence your own future. That future with its hopes and disappointments, its successes and its failures, its pleasures and its pains, its joys and its sorrows, is not hidden from your eyes. You know that these elements are mingled in every life and are to be expected in your own. And so that knowing what is before you, you will take each other from that forth from words, for richer and for poorer in sickness and in health unto death. Truly then, these words are most serious. It is a beautiful tribute to your undoubted faith in each other that recognizing their full import, you are nevertheless so willing and ready to pronounce them. Because these words involve such human, solemn obligation, it is most fitting that you rest the security of your wedded life upon the great principle of self-sacrifice. So you begin your very life by the voluntary and complete surrender of your individual lives in the interest of that deeper and wider life which you are to have in mind. Henceforth, you are to belong entirely to each other. You will be one in body, one in heart, and one in affection. And whatever sacrifice may hereafter be required to make to preserve this common life, always to be generous. Sacrifice is usually difficult and irksome. Only love can make it easy. And perfect love can make it joy. We are willing to give in proportion to love, and when love is perfect, the sacrifice is complete. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And the Son so loved us that he gave himself up for our salvation. Greater joy than this has no one, than to lay down his life for his friends. No greater blessing can come to your married life than pure, conscious love, loyal and true to the end. May God this love with which you join your hands and hearts today never fail, but grow deeper and stronger as the years go by. And if true love and the unselfish spirit of perfect sacrifice guide your reaction, you can expect the greatest measure of earthly happiness that may be allotted to man in the state of tears. The rest is in the hands of God, nor will God be wanting your needs. He will pledge you the lifelong support of his graces in the Holy Sacrament, which you are now going to receive. Father, as you come here freely and without reservation to give yourselves to each other in marriage, will you love and honor each other as men and women for the rest of your lives? Will you lovingly accept children from God and bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church? Since
it is your intention
to enter into marriage, I ask you to join your wedding bells and declare your consent before God.
Thank you.
Father, by your grace,
This is Jesus, our Lord.
secrets unite us with one another. So we may help us in our one and separate preparation. And in the sharing of one and bread and one cup. So now they combine and belong to each other. We make this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ.
Thank you. cutting of the cake.
So you're just going to grab a piece now? Okay, here's your father stealing cake.
Make a shot.
Got you again, Father. Got you again.
Mother of the groom, this is Mary Della Duca.
father of the group, Mr. George Deladuca, and his wife, Martine. Next, I'd like to introduce to you, Grandma Deladuca. Miss Lisa Walls. Tom's brother Mark Deladuca, escorting Miss Shannon Bias. And the bridesmaid and best man, Mr. Blaze Sims, escorting Holly's sister, Amy Perkins. And for the first time in public, Mr. and Mrs. Tom Deladuca.
He earned a nickname for that splendid activity of his. But we won't disclose that. Nonetheless, to talk to you, I have seen grow and change into a man of God, a man of real virtue and integrity, a man I am proud to say is my friend and brother, and to Holly Perkins, whom I toast as well, a one woman, whom it seems her childhood dreams of finding the perfect man have indeed today been fulfilled in Thomas. So to both Holly and Tom
Dillon-Dillon-Dillon,
I raise this toast to you, long, many children, much joy,